Hi, today we'll be looking at the locomotor system in anatomy and physiology. Please subscribe to this channel for more videos that will be helpful in your study. So, locomotor system is one of the functions of the important systems in anatomy and physiology, and it is the one of the key units that you need to know in anatomy and physiology. And remember, anatomy and physiology, earlier on we mentioned that we are discussing about, or rather discussing on, the structure and the function. Hence, be able to take note of the structures of the anatomy and the physiology of the locomotor system, and also the functions of those structures that we are going to come up with at the end of the day. So what is it that you expected to know at the end of this lecture? You have to be able to describe the development of the bones and its growth, and also to describe its function. Straight away, let's talk about how these bones are formed and developed. So this locomotor system, it is the system in the body that enhances the movement of body part or the body as a whole from one point to another. Now, how does the bone grow? In order for us to have the framework, remember the functions of these bones. We are going to talk about some of them. It provides the framework, the shape, and the structure. And also in the bones, that's where you're going to find the deposit of some minerals that are essential in the bone, in the body, like calcium. Now, in this case, how is it that these bones grow? So we're saying that the bone ossification, it takes place just after the commencement of life of an individual. During the fetal age, the bone growth and formation, it starts to take place. And after the 8th week, after conception, you find that there's the foundation of the bone formation. Now, what is it that we are talking about in this case? So we're saying that bone development, it can go throughout one's life. But when you talk about the bone growth, it has the point at which it ceases. That's why you find that there's a specific age where the person, when reaches at that age, the maximum age in terms of height, the person can no longer exceed that. It means that the bone growth has ceased. But development of the bones doesn't have the cessation period. It will continue throughout one's living, because there will be the repairing of the bone, the modeling. For example, if at all this fracture occurs, in order for us to have the integrity of the bone, the continuity of the bone tissue, we need to have this development to take place. That's why we are saying that development continues throughout one's life, unlike it is with the bone growth. Having talked about all that, for this to occur, having that the bone is a living tissue or organ in the body, it is composed of the cells that enables its function. What are these cells that I'm talking about? We are going to look at the function of the osteoblasts, which are the bone-forming cells. There are also osteocytes, the cells of the bone that matures the formed structures of the bone. We are also going to talk about the osteoclasts, which are the bone resorption cells, whereby when the digestion of the bone takes place, due to the fact that you want to release the calcium on the bone, you find that these cells are going to reabsorb what has been digested so as to enhance the remodeling of the bone. So these are the three primary cells that we're going to go with along with our discussion for today. So now, there are two types of bone ossification that you need to understand. Remember, this ossification, we've talked about the bone formation. There's what we call intramembranous ossification and what we call endochondral ossification. Now, when we say intramembranous ossification, what do we mean in this case? This time around, this is the replacement of the sheet-like membrane by the bone tissue. You find that primarily, there will be the formation of the tissue or the sheet-like membrane, which is going to play the role of making the structure and the framework of the body, due to the fact that when the bones are formed in this case during the fetal age, you find that it can hinder the breath of the child. But in this case, we are going to have the membrane that is able to be compressed so that it can promote breath. So in this case, we are saying that the placement of the bone tissues to that sheet-like membrane, it is called intramembranous ossification. And mostly with this type of ossification, it takes place in areas like the flat bones and those that makes up the skull and some of the irregular bones. And this is evident because you see that the size of the skull, it is bigger than the birth canal. But to promote birth, to allow these fetus to pass through the birth canal, the skull, it is composed of the membrane that is easily compressible so as to promote the birth. And the osteoblasts are one of the cells or are the cells that are essential in the replacement of this sheet-like membrane that we have talked about in intramembranous ossification for us to be able to have the bone. After the baby has been born, you find that the osteoblasts are going to migrate to the site of the membrane and are going to be surrounded by the matrix in order to come up with the osteoblast. And these osteoblasts, their function now is to play the role in the maturing the bone formed cells or the bone formed tissue in order to strengthen its integrity and be able to have the bone that can withstand the weight of the body. That is about intramembranous ossification. What about endochondral ossification that we have mentioned? Remember, we talked about two, intramembranous and endochondral ossification. So in this case, when we talk about endochondral ossification, this is a type of bone formation which takes place when the hyaline cartilage gets to be replaced by the bone tissue. And mostly it happens in the long bones. And this type of ossification is the primary ossification that takes place throughout the life of an organism or the human body during the growth period. We said that the growth ceases at around the age of early 20s. So during this period, the endochondral ossification is the one that is going to be taking place. What do we mean by this? Let's move on so that we can have a full understanding on this one. So we're saying that the hyaline cartilage, it gets to be replaced by the bone tissues. Where do we find the hyaline cartilage in the bone? It is found in the epiphyseal plate. It covers the epiphyseal plate. So you find that the bone tissue, it is going to be replacing the cartilage, the hyaline cartilage. And once the hyaline cartilage gets to be replaced, the bone increases in height. And the increment of the bone height, it means also that the body, it is increasing in terms of height. That's why you see the increment in the height of any organism, because endochondral ossification, it is taking place. And you find that most of this ossification takes part in the bone, in the bones that have got primarily the compact bone tissue. So this compact bone tissue is the one that will be replacing the hyaline cartilage that is found on top of the sponge bone tissue. You get to understand all this as we move on to when we look at the types of the tissues that makes up the bone as an organ. So the osteoblasts, just like we have mentioned earlier on, they are going to penetrate into the cartilage and they are going to replace the sponge bone. Why is it like that? Because we are going to find that this hyaline cartilage, it is lining up the sponge part of the bone. Hence, that's where ossification, it is going to take place. So the ossification is going to continue from the center towards the end of the bone. So what we mean in this case, the bone formation doesn't start from the end pores of the bone, but rather at the center of the bone. That's where the bone tissues is going to begin from. And continues to grow towards the end pores of the bone, because that's where you are going to find the hyaline cartilage that gets to be replaced by the compact bone tissue. So after the sponge bone is formed in the diaphysis, the osteoclast, they're going to break down the newly formed bone to open the medullary cavity. And it is in the medullary cavity where you're going to find the bone substances. You are going to find the matrices. You are going to find the blood vessels penetrating through, the nerves endings, all those things. Because the cavities in this case, what we're talking about is that the openings that you're going to detect in the walls of the bone. And now, this cartilage, as it is getting to be replaced, it promotes the increase in length of the bone, just like we have mentioned, promoting growth of an individual. So if this is what we are talking about, it means that when a person exceeds the period of growth, it means that there is no replacement of the hyaline cartilage, because we are saying it is only the replacement of the hyaline cartilage that can promote the increment in the length of the bone that can promote the growth of an individual. So ossification in the epiphysis is similar to that in the diaphysis, except that the sponge bone is retained instead of being broken down to form the medullary cavity. Where what you are talking about in this case is that still in the epiphysis there will be the replacement of the hyaline cartilage, just like it is with the diaphysis. But you find that in the sponge bone, you are not going to find this medullary cavity because there is no breaking down of that sponge tissue. And the medullary cavity, we talked about what is found in this medullary cavity, which is not primarily being found in the sponge bone. That's why you are not going to find the breaking down or the digestion or the tissues and the structures that makes up the sponge bone. So when the secondary ossification complete, the hyaline cartilage gets to be replaced by the bone tissue, except the two areas. What we mean in this case, there are two areas of the bone that are not going to be replaced by the compact bone tissue, which are the epiphyseal plate, both at the upper part of the bone and in the lower part. The lower end and the upper end, you are going to find the epiphyseal plate, and at the middle, that's where you are going to find the diaphysis. So what we are saying in this case is that at the diaphysis, that's where only you are going to find the replacement of the compact bone tissue, but the upper, the ends of the bone, both pores are going to remain with the cartilage that we call an articular cartilage. In this case, we are talking about the cartilage that is essential in providing the smooth movement, the movement, the joints. The unarticular, it is just another term of the joints that we're talking about. So there's just the cartilage that is going to remain at the poor end of the bone that is essential for movement of the joints. We move on. So we have talked about those two types of bone ossification. And by this time around, I'm convinced that you are able to differentiate the two and be able to describe the ossification of bones in both two types. So we are saying that the bone growth, it takes place in the epiphyseal plate, just like we've mentioned, through the replacement of the hyaline cartilage primarily. And when the cartilage growth ceases, just like we have mentioned, usually in early 20s, the epiphyseal plate completely ossifies the hyaline cartilage, and hence it remains and the bone can no longer grow in length. But now when the bone stops growing in length, does it mean that growth, or rather development, has ceased? Not really. It's only in length that the growth has stopped, but the bone is going to continue growing even in diameter. So we are saying that the bone growth primarily, it is influenced by the hormones from the adrenal hypophysis of the pituitary gland, like the growth hormone and the sex hormones. That's where you're going to see that there's a difference in terms of how a male can grow and that of the female. Why? Because it is primarily under the influence of sex hormones. So you find that in aged, as the person advances in age, like starting from adolescent, the growth, it is higher in female due to the fact that there is hypersecretion of the growth hormone compared to that of the male. So we're saying that after the growth has ceased in length of the bone, there is an increment in the diameter of the bone due to the fact that there's a mechanism taking place of osteoclast, which digests or absorbs the inner lining of the bone, and that increment in the diameter, it is called appositional growth. So you may face the question, what is an apposition growth? We're simply talking about the growth of the bone in diameter rather than in its length. So When the bone is increasing in the diameter, you find that the osteoclasts in the endosium, they are going to break down in the internal surface of the bone around the medullary cavity that we talked about, the opening of the bone. So these osteoclasts, they have an impact or a mechanism of digesting the inner lining of the bone and increasing its diameter. And these processes together, they increase the diameter of the bone, just like we have alluded to. And here we can see the picture that is showing how the growth of the bone takes place. So if you've noticed, this part on top here, that's where the bone grows from. And we can see that, just like we have mentioned earlier, that growth of the bone takes place starting from the center to the end pose. So if you've noticed here, at the center, we can see this brown matter that is showing to point at the ossification that is taking place. There's a replacement of the tissue of the by the bone tissue. So that's how it is going. And at the end, we can see that now the bone, it is fully occupied by the bone tissue. So this part in between, that's what we are talking about. That's what we are calling the compact bone tissue. It is composed of the compact tissue, and it is called the diaphysis. Then at the both ends, upper and lower end here, we can see there's this hyaline line that is bifurcating from the diaphysis. That's what we call epiphyseal plate containing the epiphysis and the sponge tissue. Then we can see inner part, there are blood vessels that are protruding through the compact bone tissue. So this is how bone growth takes place. After looking at that, we talked about the types of bone tissues in summary. But now we can talk about them specifically. What is it that you were talking about? Let's have a solid understanding on this one. So when you're dealing with the types of bone tissues, we said that there are two. It could be the compact or the sponge bone tissue. So the compact bone tissue, just by its name, compact, it means that the cells of this tissue are closely packed together, giving it the thicker density and its thickness and their strength, because it is the tissue that primarily bears the weight of the body. So we're saying that the osteoblasts are bone forming cells, and osteoclasts are going to reabsorb or break down the bone, and osteocytes are mature bone cells that are going to maintain the equilibrium or the bone that is being digested and that is being formed. So what we are primarily mean in this case, in order for us to have this compact bone, remember we talked about the cavities that are going to be formed. So the cavities in the bone are going to be formed by the osteoclast. The osteoblasts, they are going to aid in the formation of the cells. Then the osteocytes are going to maintain the equilibrium between the mechanism of the osteoblast and that of the osteoclast. Because if at all we have the hyper mechanism of osteoclast than that of the osteoblast, it means that we are going to have the condition like we can talk about osteoporosis, in a sense that the bone, it is going to lose its integrity. But with an aid of this osteoblast, it's going to maintain the integrity so that and the equilibrium so that we can have the strong bone in this case. So the compact bone, it consists of closely packed osteons or the Havesian system, just like we have mentioned. And the osteocytes that we have talked about are going to be found inside this Havesian system in the location called the lacunae. So the lacunae, what we're talking about is just the site within the bone where you're going to find the osteocytes. And here we've got an example, or rather the edge that is showing us the compact bone. So we're saying that along this diaphysis that we just mentioned in the bone growth, that's where you are going to find the compact bone tissue. So like you are seeing here at this diagram has just been isolated from the whole bone here. So it is showing how cells of the compact bone tissue are closely compacted together or packed together. And if you can see here, it is showing that this is the part of the compact bone tissue. And what is it that we are going to find in the compact bone tissue? They are going to be the blood stem cells. We are going to have the bone for the blood cells, because that's where blood it is being formed within the bone. So there will be the red blood cells, you are going to find the white blood cells and the platelets from the its production, just like you can see here as it is being demonstrated. So we are saying that in compact bone you are going to find the cells that are closely packed together and gives it a solid mass. That's why if you have just a bone, I guess we have all come in contact with a bone, we are able to visualize what we are talking about. The middle part of the bone, it is going to appear as a solid mass due to the package of the cells that makes up the compact bone. Quite all right, having looked at what this compact bone tissue is, what is the sponge tissue? In this case, we are talking about the tissue that is going to be found in the epiphyseal plate, just like we have mentioned. And its appearance, it is said to be a cancellous bone, which is lighter and denser, because all the spongy structures that it has makes it to be lighter. And it contains the red bone marrows, where erythropoiesis and the just production of the blood cells is being done. So we're saying that the canaliculi connects to the adjacent cavities instead of a central Havitian canal to receive their blood supply. So you find that along the bone, there is a mechanism that joins up the blood supply so that it can all receive the oxygenated blood. And once the blood is being produced, it can be distributed to the entire circulatory system. From those types of bone tissues, you can also have to know the classification of bones. We have talked about the two types of bone ossification, which is intramembranous and endochondral ossification. We have also talked about two types of bone tissues, which is the compact bone tissue and the sponge bone tissue. Now, what about the types of bones now? Quite all right, we've got what we call long bones. Long bones, we are saying that they are primarily made up of the compact bone tissue, and this is evidenced looking at the structures that we have demonstrated earlier. And they consist a long shaft with two bulk ends or extremities, and these ends that we are talking about are now what we are referring to, the spongy part of the bone or in the epiphyseal plate. And mostly these bones are found in the extremities, like examples of the long bones, we can talk about the thigh bone, which is the femur. You can talk about the leg bone, both the fibula and tibia. You can talk about the arm bone, which is the humerus, and forearm, the radius and the ulna. These are examples of the long bones. And here we have demonstrated on the image that is showing the long bone. So we were saying that it is primarily made up of the compact bone. Remember, the compact tissue, it is found in the diaphysis. And here you can see it is showing that this is the diaphysis. So from all this part length coming up to this end, we can see that this is actually the compact bone, because it is denoting the diaphysis. Then at the far end here, at the end, that's where you are going to find the sponge bone. Both parts, there is epiphysis and epiphysis dia. So there is a proximal epiphysis and the diastole epiphysis, which is showing that all these are containing the sponge bone tissues. And we can see the labyrinths about only this long bone. Then we can also talk about the short bones. It's one of the types of bones. What are we talking about when you talk about the short bone? These are primarily made up of the sponge bone, but containing the thin layer of the compact bone which covers it. And examples of the short bone, we can talk about the wrist and the ankles. And in the diagram here, we are showing these types of bones. So we can see the tarsals, the carpals, all these are examples of the short bones. So what we are saying, or what you need to understand when the short bones, is that they are primarily made up of the sponge bone. And they are not, actually its diameter and the length does not differ much. That's why we are saying that it is a short bone. We move on. We can also talk about the flat bone. Flat bones is just one type of the bones that we are talking about in terms of the classifications. So the flat bones are also primarily made up of the sponge bone, but covered with a thin layer of compact bone. And we are giving an example of these flat bones, like the cranium. The cranium, these are the bones of the skull. They are the flat bones. And we can also talk about the irregular bones, which is also another type. So these are irregular bones, are bones that do not have the specific shape that can be describable. And examples of these irregular bones, we can talk about those bones that makes up the vertebral column, are irregular. They are not long, they are not short, they are not flat, but rather irregular shaped, primarily composed of the spongy bone, but with a line of a thin layer of the compact bone, which protects its content inside. And in this visual aid, it is demonstrating what we are talking about. So here we are talking about the vertebral bones. You can talk about the cervical vertebrates, you can talk about the thoracic vertebrates, lumbar vertebrates, sacrum vertebrates, and the coccyx. All those types of bones are irregular in terms of shape. Then you can come to the flat bones. There's a cranium, the bones that makes up the skull. You can talk about the sternum. The sternum is also an example of the flat bone. Talk about the ribs or the scapula and the clavicle bone. These are examples of the flat bones that we are talking about. So what have we said in this case? We said that in terms of the classifications or the types of bones, we've got what we call long bones, short bones, flat bones, and irregular bones. Please go through the video, review it, so that you can able to get the full understanding. And this is the end of today's lecture. Next time we meet, we are going to continue talking about the joints. So don't forget to like the video, you can give the comments, and share with your friends so that you can able to benefit together. Don't forget to subscribe so that you can able to receive the videos next time. Thank you.